Good morning, everyone. For those that are used to this, help me out. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Ah, amen. What a blessed resurrection morning that we call Easter Sunday. I want to welcome all of you. If you happen to be new today, I'm Pastor Bruce, the lead pastor here, and you are very welcome. And if you're online with us today, you are also very welcome. A few quick announcements for us today. The first one, really important we all pay attention to this. Next Sunday is April the 7th, right? Yeah, okay, good. I'm glad we all agree. We are having soup lunch after church. Y'all like soup, right? Everybody like soup? Come on, you like soup. Because soup is, as you know, super. Sorry, had to do it. So here's the thing though. We have a sign-up sheet at the welcome desk out here. We need you to sign up to bring soup. Okay? We need you to sign up to bring soup. Now, I know some of you have a specialty soup that you do. You've got your trademark soup, and I probably have not tried it. And I would like to try it. So please sign up to bring more soup. And if you're here and you're like, hold it, soup is not my thing. I do not make soup. Don't worry. We need people to bring things like squares or baking because man cannot live by soup alone. No sign up required for that. Just bring stuff next week, okay? Donuts, my wife says. No nuts. Sorry. I thought she said donuts, but hey, if anybody makes those Mennonite donuts with the raisins in them, I forget what they're called. Those are always good. But then we gotta bring watermelon then, I think. Yeah, but that's all good too. So anyways, yeah, please, we stay away from nuts as best we can. Much like we stay away from scents here as best we can because of people with allergies and breathing issues. Like, look at these. Aren't they amazing? And they're not real, just so you know. Or else we'd have somebody drop, probably. So we just stay away from that. A couple other quick announcements for you. First one is this. The day before soup lunch is April the 6th. The community garden team, so if you haven't noticed yet, on that end of the building, we have a wonderful community garden in the fenced area. The team that oversees that in the community is having a large amount of soil brought on April the 6th at 11 a.m. They could use help. So if you like to shovel dirt and garden and stuff, I would encourage you to take part in that. Also, ladies, April the 27th, the Be Still Ladies Retreat, 9 till 3. Please sign up at the welcome desk. All ladies are invited to attend. The sign up is not because, well, if you forget to sign up, you can't come. It's actually to get a good number for lunch. So please sign up so that Brenda and the rest of the ladies ministries team can handle that. Lastly, or I guess two more things for you. Sunday, May 5th, again, there's a sign-up sheet at the desk there. Anybody interested in talking about baptism on Sunday, May 5th, after the service, I'm going to have a meeting. I'll probably feed you, and so for those that sign up, and we'll talk about baptism so that we can have a baptism service this summer down at the lake, which is awesome. I love it. And lastly, you'll notice that we now have got in your bulletin, so check the bulletin out for all sorts of stuff. There's a section now down here, which has all sorts of weekly regular events on it. So make note of those things as well. And please, we would encourage you, if you're new with us, things that you see listed, like men's prayer or ladies' study or youth group, depending on your age and whatnot, please come and join us. We would love to get to know you some more. Let's bow for a word of prayer, and then we've got a special treat for you. Heavenly Father, you are good. You are full of wisdom and grace. And from all eternity past, it is you, Father, that had a beautiful plan of salvation in your mind. And we are so grateful here today that out of your plan, Jesus, the eternal Son, came, lived a wonderful, sinless life, willingly went to the cross. And as we celebrate today, he rose again, displaying victory over sin and death. And oh, that we can celebrate him today. We are forever grateful for all that he does in our lives. And I pray, Father, that you would strengthen us through your Spirit that resides in us, that we would live our faith, that we would journey with you, Lord, in obedience, surrendered to you, honoring you with our lives. And I pray that all that we do in this place today would honor you, and that you would be celebrated. We thank you for this church. We thank you for all that you bring to us here. And we pray, Lord, that we would humbly walk before you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
It was Passover week. As the religious leaders plotted against him, Jesus met with his friends for a special Passover meal. He reminded them, "In this world you will have trouble, but be encouraged. I have won the battle over the world." After dinner, Jesus led his friends to a lonely garden. He cried out to God, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup of suffering away from me. But do what you want, not what I want." As Jesus prayed, a mob arrived to arrest him. Jesus could have called down bright angels from heaven. Instead, he allowed the mob to take him. All of Jesus' followers ran away or cowered in the darkness. As Jesus was given a fake trial, his closest friend, Peter, denied even knowing Jesus. "I don't know him." The religious leaders could not sentence Jesus to die. So early Friday morning, they sent him to the Roman governor, Pilate. Pilate questioned Jesus, but found him innocent. Still, the crowd cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate didn't want to cause trouble with the religious leaders, so he handed Jesus over to die. Soldiers forced Jesus to carry his own heavy cross through the streets of Jerusalem to a lonely hill outside the city. Jesus, the light of the whole world, was nailed to a rough wooden cross. At noon, the sun vanished and the sky went dark. At last, Jesus cried out, "It is finished," and gave up his life. It was the darkest moment the world has ever known. The light of the world was gone. Jesus's body was taken to a simple tomb cut into the rock. A heavy stone was rolled to block the entrance. Jesus's friends huddled together behind locked doors. But in the darkness, God was at work. Friday evening, Saturday, Sunday, In the darkness of Sunday morning, three women who were friends of Jesus went to the tomb to place spices on his body. But they found the stone had been rolled away, and the tomb was empty. Two brilliant angels appeared. The women were frightened, but the angels told them, "Jesus is not here. He has risen." The women were overjoyed and ran to tell the rest of Jesus' friends. The news was hard to believe. How could death be undone? But later that day, Jesus suddenly stood among them. He said, "May you have peace." The incredible news was true. Jesus, the light of the whole world, is alive. Jesus gave up his life and died in our place. When he returned to life, death and darkness were beaten forever. Now, everyone who follows Jesus can walk in the light and live forever with God.
Let us reenact for you those moments where they met Jesus. Mary made her way to the tomb. Now she discovered that the tomb rolled, the stone had rolled away. An angel appeared to her. And Mary was astonished. The angel said to her,
"Jesus is not here. He has risen."
Jesus. Mary was overjoyed. She ran to tell Peter. Jesus is alive. The news was true. Okay. Come. They come. Jesus was alive.
I'm the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
The incredible news was true. Jesus, the light of the whole world, was alive. When Jesus returned to life, death and darkness were defeated forever. Now everyone who follows Jesus can walk in the light and live forever with God. Good job. want to say thank you to Matthias, who was playing Peter. And I want to say thank you to Jemima, who was playing the angel. And I want to say thank you to Michael, who was playing Jesus. And I want to say thank you to Samantha, who is playing Mary. Can we give them a hand? They were portraying the incredible news of Jesus' resurrection. Let me finish by saying, there is a lot of pain and brokenness and darkness in our world, but Easter helps us to connect, helps us connect to the bright, bright light of hope. Truth is, every single one of us has turned away from God. We have all sinned. We have all done wrong things that hurt others and broke our relationship with God. But God loved us enough to give up everything by sending Jesus to live with us as a human being. Jesus showed us perfectly what it means to love God and love others. And then Jesus gave up his life in our place. Even though Jesus lived a perfect life, he took our consequences. When God raised Jesus back to life, the power of sin was broken. Now everyone who chooses to follow Jesus can be reconnected to God, and we will get to live with God forever. Is Jesus in your heart? The risen Savior can be your personal friend. Isn't that an amazing news? We have Jesus in our heart. We're going to live with him in heaven someday. Amen. Thank you for participating with us.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. Romans 8 says this: who can bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is seated at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. There is no condemnation through Christ Jesus, through what he has done for us on the cross. And this resurrection that we celebrate today is a pivotal, pivotal point in history. So, in light of that, this amazing worship team up here, we are planning to raise the roof today, and we invite you to raise it with us in worship and praise of our living Savior. So please stand.
Oh, Time we would like to call the ushers forward. Let's pray for this morning's offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the many gifts you give us. We pray that you would take these offerings that we give and multiply them for your glory. May you bless us this day, and may you be blessed this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
And we're going to sing a song for you right now. We're going to have the words up on the screen so you can follow along. We'd just like to bless you with this number.
Our scripture reading today is from the book of John. If you would like to turn there in your Bible with me, if you don't bring your Bible to church, there should be one in the chair in front of you. John chapter 5. We'll be reading from verses 19 to 29. I'll invite you to stand as we read God's word together. Jesus gave them this answer. I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, to your amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, Even so, the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he also has granted to the Son to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. May God bless the reading of his word. Please be seated.
Thank you, Greg. Appreciate that. Today, as we continue in our series in the Gospel of John, it's interesting how this works. See, months ago, I'm working through the list that I have of which sermons and how we're breaking up John and doing this. Then what I do is I then begin to throw it into a calendar so we know when it's coming. It happened to be today's theme was resurrection. That's what the Spirit of God does. Wasn't that I was being so strategic. That's what God does. So, I am very thankful for that, because then we don't sort of hit a day like today and go, well, let's, you know, set aside our John series and do something different. It is the exact fit that we needed. So you'll notice we're covering the same verses, if you were here last week, that we did last week. But last week, we talked about roles, responsibility, Jesus, God the Son, the Father, the Spirit, how the Trinity kind of functions. And then we talked about what do we do? How do we serve in light of that, in reminder of the example of Christ, of the Trinity, actually, in how service is to be done. And those are great reminders for us. So you'll see that today we are going to, again, we'll kind of bypass some of these verses because we really covered them last week, and then we'll focus on other ones. So, Jesus, the risen Savior, we're going to talk about resurrection today. So last week, like I said, we talked about verse 19, right? We talked about Jesus does what the Father is doing. We talked about that wonderful relationship of submission and that it is out of love, right? And that Jesus was going to do greater things. And then Jesus actually says that when the Spirit comes, there will be even greater things as well. So, but then we hit this wonderful verse 21. The Father raises the dead. Now, I want you to consider this. We're going to talk today, we're going to look at a few other passages, but the Father is the one who raised Jesus back to life. That's how this happened. I had somebody once say to me, so, like, did Jesus just kind of decide, okay, 3 days, okay, now it's time, I'm just going to kind of get up? Because, you know, he is God the Son. That's not how it happened. And we're going to look at some texts that remind us of the truth of this, but it is actually even right here. The Father himself raises the Son to life. And the Son also raises people to life because he does what the Father is doing, right? So resurrection is a theme that is broader than Easter, though at Easter we take a special focus on it. And we'll talk about why that is a little later as well. So then we get these reminders about judgment and how the Father has given judgment as a role and responsibility to the Son, which is an important thing for us to be reminded of. And then we get this great reminder of the gospel, of those who hear the word, hear what Jesus has to say and believe, will receive eternal life. Do you understand, though, when we say eternal life, what we mean? We're talking about eternal resurrection. It is the resurrection theme. It is an eternity in heaven with God, not just spiritually, but physically as well. New heaven, new earth, new body. That's all because of the same resurrection that we're talking about today. Can't get away from passages like this. A lot of people would ask me questions about this over the years. What does it mean when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God? Well, we're going to talk a little bit about that today too. It's an important thing. It's not officially a resurrection piece, but it is an Easter piece. You see, Jesus didn't stop preaching the truth of who he is and the kingdom of God because of the cross. He continued it. He continued it. And what I mean by that is, when Jesus, and we actually sung part of about it today, but when Jesus was on the cross, and the language is always clear. The Bible is on purpose the way that it is. God uses particular words and language on purpose. No, nothing hidden. We sometimes struggle because we translate things into English, and English is not the original language, and it sometimes doesn't give us an accurate picture, and our language changes. But on the cross, Jesus says to the thief, who kind of defends him to the other thief, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." He didn't use the word heaven. He used the word paradise. What was paradise? Well, paradise was, you read through the Old Testament, and you'll hear these great passages, you know, like Jacob says, I was going through later parts of Genesis and Exodus today in my Bible time, and Jacob says that, you know, if they go and they take Benjamin and this and that, maybe his head will go down to Sheol. Maybe he will die. Maybe he will go to the grave. So there was Sheol, the place of the dead. One side being Hades, one side being paradise. And we get pictures of this. Jesus gives a great illustration of it when he tells a parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And the rich man is in Hades, and Lazarus is in paradise with Abraham. So what it gives us the picture of is throughout the time prior to the cross, those who were people of faith, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, you could know many Old Testament saints, they're waiting. Waiting for Jesus, waiting for the Messiah. Jesus, when he dies on the cross, where does he go? Paradise. Why? Because he deserves no death. He is the righteous one. He doesn't go to Hades. The teaching came along later by people because of, I believe, a misapplication of the Bible that somehow Jesus went to hell. Not true. In fact, hell isn't in play until Revelation 20. It's called the lake of fire. It actually isn't in use yet. It says that death and Hades get cast into the lake of fire, the second death. So when we talk about hell, we're talking about the lake of fire. Hades is where those who are enemies of God, those who are unrepentant, those who are not dealing with their sin, those who do not recognize Jesus, are waiting for final judgment. Paradise, though, Jesus goes, he is celebrated. He proclaims God's kingdom has come. And all those guys have been waiting for him. And it talks about he leads a host of captives free. That's them. It talks about those saints of old who came out of graves. Where had they been? Were they just in the ground? No, they were in paradise spiritually. Bodies were in the ground. The dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. It's not a second chance scheme. It is a proclamation to those in the Old Testament who loved God and were waiting for Jesus. That's what that verse is talking about. It's not a second chance thing. It's not some concept of, we hope we're just going to be able to get this other chance because the dead are going to hear, and if they hear, they'll live. No, no. It's a one-time deal. It happened when Jesus and his body was in the grave and his spirit was in paradise. So, we come back to the Father having life and granting the Son life. We talked about that. Judgment, we talked about that last week. But again, it comes back to this same concept I just talked about. Hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice. Whose voice? Jesus' voice. And they are going to come out, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment. So again, referencing final judgment, and again, Jesus is the judge. We talked about that last week. But there's a resurrection theme here. And why is it important that we recognize resurrection? Because we are actually contrary to the thinking of the world, contrary to the thinking of what we would call modern science. You're actually an eternal being. Well, not eternal like God, not timeless from all time past, but you are made for future eternal existence. The question is it going to be with God or not? Is it going to be in new heaven and new earth, or is it going to be in hell? Either way, you're going to be resurrected from grave, from where we are waiting. So those who are enemies of God waiting in Hades, those who love God waiting in heaven spiritually, but resurrected physically for a day of judgment. And it talks about that in Revelation, what I alluded to earlier. And so we be reminded that resurrection is not merely an issue of discussion around Jesus 2,000 years ago. It's not only an issue for Christians. It is an everybody issue. The resurrection unto judgment is real. And is why the urgency of the gospel is so important. So there's a great little verse here. It gets quoted in Acts chapter 2 when Peter is preaching. It's actually out of Psalm 16 verse 10. And it's great because it's David, but technically it's about Jesus. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. It's talking about Jesus. It's not talking about David. Peter gives us that clarity in the book of Acts. There's no doubt. Jesus goes to the place of the dead, and he does not stay there. His body does not rot away and decay. It does not see corruption. Nor does his soul. Nor does his soul. Jesus. And here we have another great text that reminds us about what Jesus did when he resurrected, when he rose from the grave. When he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and gave gifts to men. So we'll talk in coming weeks at some point about the ascension. We'll eventually get there, don't worry. But that's what this is talking about. And who's the host of captives? Those who were waiting to hear his voice in paradise. And so now, they are no longer in paradise. Paradise is empty. It's not in use. When the Apostle Paul would say, when we are absent from this body as those who follow Christ, we are present with the Lord. We are in heaven. Oh, what joy. What joy to know that when you and I who are in Christ pass from this existence, spiritually, we are with God. How wonderful. That's where we wait. I tell you, Could it be 1,000 years? 2,000? Would I care? No! What better place to wait but with the Lord? How wonderful that is. So then we get this reminder in Ephesians. In saying he ascended, what does it mean that he also descended into the lower regions of the earth, the place of the dead? He who descended is the one who ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. Jesus. Jesus. So it's an important reminder for us about what Jesus did during those 3 days, during what we call the sign of Jonah. Jesus himself calls it that. For just like Jonah spends 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so the Son of Man will spend 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. Right? So Jesus isn't just laying in the ground. He's working. He's preaching. He's proclaiming to those in paradise and then leads them to freedom when he ascends. So, in 1 Peter, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the cross, the righteous for the unrighteous in our place, right? If you don't understand today that you're part of the unrighteous, I would encourage you to consider that. Jesus is the only one who has righteousness on his own. Nobody else. I know in our humanity, people like to think themselves pretty good. But even thinking of ourselves pretty good displays that we are unrighteous, because it's prideful. You see, at the depth of who we are as people, we are flawed and sinful. And one of our biggest sins is that we think we're actually pretty good. And we're not. And we're not. If nothing else, every single one of us in the last day has had a thought which does not honor God. Even if you didn't act on it, you thought it, Jesus says that's enough. That's how sinful we are. It's not just the result of our actions, it is out of the heart of our humanity. So the beauty of the gospel here, Christ, the righteous one, the one who has no sin, the one who never had such thoughts, the one who never committed things against the Father, against the law, against God, that righteous one went to the cross for us because of our sin. But why? That he might bring us to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but he was made alive in the spirit. That's why when Christ is resurrected, he's resurrected to never die again. See, it's different. You know, when Jesus resurrected his friend Lazarus, so there's a great story in the Bible about a guy by the name of Lazarus. He's got a couple of sisters, Mary and Martha. We're not going to turn there today. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but he dies. Jesus shows up, and it's been like 4 days. And Jesus calls out and says, Lazarus, come on out, come forth. And Lazarus comes out of that tomb alive. And everybody is astounded, right? Jesus spoke, and this guy walks out alive. He's been dead 4 days. That's incredible, right? It's remarkable. But you know what? Some years later, who knows how long, Lazarus died again. He wasn't transformed by the Spirit of God to a newness of life for eternity. Jesus was made alive in the Spirit for all eternity, never to die again. That's different. That's different than any other resurrection you see in the Scriptures. And it is what you and I who are in Christ are headed for. That is the resurrection we get to share in for eternity. One that is eternal. One that puts us forever, for all eternity, with God. And so here again, the verse I alluded to earlier, Jonah, 3 days, 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so the Son of Man, 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Just talking about Jesus spending the time in the grave. But we want to talk about the importance of the resurrection in the gospel. It's not just the fact that it happened. And you can do your homework. You can read through the New Testament, and there are many accounts of Jesus, the resurrected one. In fact, the Apostle Paul says there's at least 500 people that spent time with the resurrected Jesus, that saw him, that experienced him resurrected. To me, there is more evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ than there is of a lot of other things that historians like to hold on to from history. And so you can do your own research if you don't believe me, but the resurrection is actually a key component of our belief about the gospel. So the Apostle Paul in Galatians 1, he's just introducing himself. He's just saying, listen, this is who's writing the letter. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. The Father raised Jesus the Son from the grave. That's how it happened. And it's key to our identity in Christ. It is a key belief of our faith. It's not an option. We can't believe Christ paid for our sins and stayed in the grave. We cannot believe that because it is lacking. It is without hope. And when you read, the Apostle Paul actually deals with that clearly in some texts, especially in Corinthians, that the resurrection is required to understand the gospel. And even in how we identify ourselves, do we understand? If you are here today and you say, well, I'm a Christian, that means you're one who is following the risen Lord Jesus. That's what it means. It doesn't mean, I read all these things about what Jesus did while he lived, and that's what I do, so I'm a Christian. I follow all that. No, that's important. But if you are not following the living Savior, you're not actually following Jesus. You're following a bunch of teachings. He is living. He has risen. The Father raised him. In fact, we look at the gospel here in Romans 10. If you confess, this is, when we talk about the scriptures, you're going to have texts that are very prescriptive. There, you do something, okay? You are to respond to it. And texts that are very descriptive, they give us information and understanding, okay? So, if you confess, our response, what we do, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, God, that's the Father, raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Salvation includes understanding and believing the resurrection. Because if Christ is not raised, if he is not living eternally resurrected, what hope have we to do the same? We find that hope in him. If he is not raised, how does he later come, vanquish the enemies of God, and bring in the day of judgment? He does all of that because he was raised. And so then in Romans earlier, in chapter 7, likewise, my brother, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for God. So if you're here today and you don't have a living relationship with Jesus, the risen Savior, that is what you need. That is the most important thing. And it begins like this. It begins by recognizing the fact that I am broken, I am sinful, I am without hope on my own. And often we think, I'll just try harder. Maybe if I just do a little extra, I'll give to charity and I'll help people in need. I'll start being really kind to everybody. And then, you know, God will be happier with me. No. Whatever you do from this point forward in your life will never erase your sin. And judgment day will come and the books will be opened and your sin exposed, and you will end up in hell. That's what happens on judgment day. Unless you believe, put your faith, your trust, your whole being in surrender to Jesus Christ. Him and Him alone is where we find salvation. Our resurrected Lord, the one who displayed victory over death and who ascends on high. He is the one that we are saved by, and Him alone. And if you do that, you place your faith and trust in Him. You recognize you're a sinner, and you believe that He died for you. He took your sin. He paid the price for it, so you don't have to. You just have to trust Him and live for Him. You surrender your life to Him. I'm no longer in control. Jesus, the living Savior, is in control of me now. And so I do what I call repenting. Right? Scripture talks about repent. Acts chapter 2, Peter gives a great sermon. The guys say, what do we do? What do we do? And he says, repent. Turn. Turn from your sin and do righteous. Turn and become more like Jesus. Live like Him. Turn from your self-driven sinful ways and be baptized. Then we are saved, and this book opens. It's a scroll, really. But for our context, we don't understand scrolls well. And in there, if that's you, you surrendered to Christ. He's your Lord. He's your Savior. You recognized your sin and placed your trust in Jesus to save you and forgive you. Your name gets written. And on judgment day, that scroll gets opened. And it's like, oh, yeah, Brenda's in there. See, Brenda came to Christ. I won't tell you her testimony. Brenda came to Christ here at this church on an Easter Sunday many, many years ago. Praise God. And at that point, on that day, in that scroll, Brenda. And on judgment day, that scroll gets opened. Brenda, come on in. We've been waiting for you. Your name? Right here. You don't want to be in the other books. You don't want to take your chance on that. It's not going to go well. And if that is you today, you're like, yes, I recognize that. I am saved. I believe. I trust Jesus. Good. Risen Savior leads us, guides us. He is the one we are about in order that we may bear fruit for Him. We're to be about His work. We talked about that some last week. That's for all of us who are in Christ. He has a mission for you. He has a job for you to do. He calls us to be involved in the ministry of His kingdom. And so I encourage you to do that. Lastly, Romans chapter 8. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the Holy Spirit, right? Who rose Jesus? The Father. So, the Spirit of Him is God the Holy Spirit, the third member of the Trinity. So if the Holy Spirit is in you, dwells in you, lives in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. That is our hope. That is for everybody who is saved. You don't have to go to this church to receive that. If you are in Christ, this promise is for you. God, the Holy Spirit, resides in you. That's a promise. It is a gift. It is beautiful. And he secures us, not just through this life to eternity, but it is by him that you are going to be one day resurrected physically for eternity. By the very person, God the Holy Spirit. What a wonderful promise that is. And so today, as we prepare to come to the table, to be reminded of the work of Jesus on the cross, I always want to make sure we come to the table on Easter Sunday. What better day to celebrate the body and the blood of Christ than on the day we celebrate the resurrected Jesus? Right? It's a wonderful reminder. But I would encourage you that as you prepare your hearts for this, that you consider the gospel, that you consider Jesus, the risen Savior. Are you living your life for him or for yourself? Do you have a living relationship with him, or do you just know about him? Do you live surrendered to him, or are you at a point in your life where for some reason you've decided that you know better than God? And I would encourage you to do business with God today. As we prepare for the table, we're going to do a few things. I'm going to pray in a minute. We are then, we're going to together declare. I like that better than recite. I think recite is kind of poor. We're going to declare what we call the Apostles' Creed, what we believe about God, about Christ, about the gospel. And so for those of you here today where that's not true in your life, I don't want you to declare it if it's not true. But even the moment we are declaring that, you can make that true in your life. You can read that through with us with believing faith, surrendering your life to Christ. It doesn't take a special altar call. It doesn't take some particular booklet or tract. It takes surrendering your life to Christ. God knows your heart. We encourage you to use your words. But most importantly, God knows your heart. And so I'm going to encourage you today, whether it is when we're declaring the creed or when we are partaking of the bread and the cup, only do what is true in your heart. You don't need to be false here. I'd like to hope that we're honest here and transparent, or we should be growing in that direction. So when the time comes and we are passing the elements around, feel free. If that's not where you're at today, you pass it on by. We would rather that than you pretend. Okay, so we don't need to pretend here. It's okay. Nobody's going to look down on you for that. Nobody's going to think less of you. Okay, that's not who we are here, and we don't believe that's what God would want for us. Instead, we would encourage you to get to know Jesus or get your life right with God. So let's pray, and then we will take some time, declare the creed, and prepare for the table. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are the amazing one who raised Jesus from the grave. And because of that, we can have an amazing hope in him for eternity. We can believe and be saved because of all that you have done in Jesus and through him. We recognize today that there is no other way to be saved. And we recognize today that it is not our performance. It is not us living our lives a particular way that somehow saves us. We don't get to add to it. We don't get to beef it up a little bit with some extra. Because Jesus is fully sufficient for everything we need, and especially in our salvation. We thank you that you do not just leave us alone. You don't leave us like orphan children. Instead, you give us the Spirit to dwell in us, that we may live our lives knowing your presence, being strengthened and cared for by you. And so, Father, as we come to you today, I pray that we would be reminded of these deep things. Lord, soften our hearts, that we would be quick to do business with you, that as the Spirit convicts us of sin, that we would be quick to confess, quick to repent, quick to embrace righteousness instead of sin, that we would live our lives honoring Jesus, our living Savior. Help us, strengthen us, that we would more and more be a people of your word and of prayer, a people who follow the example of Jesus, learning to love you and love others well, to your honor and glory. And now, as we go to the table, Lord, may we do so with an openness of heart, recognizing everything about Jesus that is true from your word, that we base our faith on that. Thank you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that we can take time to gather today in remembrance of the resurrection of our living Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll just take a minute if you need to prepare your heart, and then we will recite the creed, and then we'll go to the table. So I'll get you to stand with me if you're able. And we will speak this together. So I'll try not to speak too fast, because sometimes I'm told I speak fast. And as I said before, if this is true for you, please join us in this declaration. I believe in God the Father Almighty, and in Christ Jesus, his only Son, our Lord, who was born from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, who under Pontius Pilate was crucified and buried. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, from where he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the flesh, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. I'll ask those who are coming to serve at the table today to come on forward. And I'll remind you of the origin from the book of Matthew, chapter 26, of what we're about to do. Matthew 26, starting in the 26th verse. The context is that Jesus is having his last meal, his last supper, as we often call it. By the way, if you're in Ireland, they would say that's dinner. We're okay with that. And here's what goes on, starting in verse 26. Now, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." So, that would have been sort of like this. And he would have handed it out, you know, he would have torn it. I'm going to have to apologize to the custodians later. But, and I strategically chose a flatbread. Might not have looked exactly like this. But it would have been unleavened. And sometime we'll do a series on the Passover and the importance of these things. But you see, it's unleavened because leaven, yeast, any leavening agent, was understood as being a symbol of sin. That's why Jesus warned the disciples to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees at one point. This is a descriptor of sin. This is the imagery of Jesus' body without sin. No sin. And he says, "Take and eat it." And then he says, takes a cup. When he'd given thanks for it, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant." Probably wasn't a cup like this, though it might have been something like this. Blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Of sins. These are important things. The body of Christ, broken for us. The blood of Christ, shed for us. These are critical to our faith. And as we remember today, I want us to be reminded the body of Christ, his humanity. He actually had what I will tell you, and I believe this to be true, were new experiences for God. Somebody once said, "What do you mean new experiences?" I say, well, God the Son comes in the flesh and he understands hunger and thirst. He understands fatigue and struggle. He all of a sudden understood pain in a physical sense. It's all represented in his body. And that was broken and endured. He underwent that in our place. His body broken for us. So let's give thanks for the bread, and then we will hand it out, and then we will partake together in remembrance. Thank you, Father, for the great wisdom you had that Jesus would come, fully God and fully man, to walk this life like the rest of us in difficulty, with hunger, with thirst, with fatigue, with soreness and pain, and that he endured it all out of the massive love for us, culminating with his willingness to go to the cross, to be beaten and whipped and shamed and mistreated, lied about, and killed in our place. Oh, Father, it breaks me that Jesus did that because of my sin. And I am so thankful that he did. Lord, help us that we would remember this always. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are told in God's word that we do this in remembrance. So that means we've thought it about it, we've pondered it, and that it is actually the body of Christ broken for us. Jesus in my place. So let us together remember the body of Christ broken for us.
Let's pray for the cup. Oh, Holy Father, as we remember today the work of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the Living One, how wonderful it is to be reminded of His blood shed for us. The blood that washes away our sin. The blood that is a gift that brings newness of life. The blood with which you write a new covenant. So those who are in Christ are now your children and heirs along with Jesus for eternity. What a wonderful and beautiful gift. May we always be reminded by you, Lord, of the amazing gift of the blood of Christ shed for us. May we live daily in reminder of the beautiful salvation that it brings. That through the shed blood of Christ, we have forgiveness and righteousness and life and eternity. Father, thank you for this cup. Thank you for all that it represents. Thank you that we can remember together. In the name of Jesus, amen. in similar fashion, we remember together the blood of Christ shed for us to take away our sin. What a wonderful gift. Let's remember together. Now, I think we're going to sing a song because we should be celebrating because of what we have just remembered. If you know Jesus and you are here today, celebrate in the forgiveness that you have received. Amen? Amen. Let's stand together if you're able and join with the worship team.
And if you know Jesus, one day we're going to be singing up in heaven with him. Imagine that. So let's get some practice in while we're down here.
To look upon the one who lives.
for our benediction today. Hebrews 13, 20 and 21, for all who will receive it. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thanks for joining us today, everybody. We are concluding our service, and we do have coffee and tea after, so please stick around and fellowship.